Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
50 years ago, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin became the first humans to ever land on the moon. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind, that whole thing. Astronauts also brought back the first samples of the moon. They brought back rocks and soil from the lunar surface.
These boxes include the samples of various types of rock, the ground mass of the soil, the sand and silt.
Having Apollo samples here on the ground where we can study them changed the entire field of planetary science. It's revealed stuff not only about the moon, but about how other planetary surfaces change and evolve. And we continue to study them today. They're still revealing secrets about the moon itself and the rest of the solar system. NASA keeps most of those samples at the NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston in a secure, pristine clean room that I got to go visit. I showed up at the lab and I met Charisse Kreischer.
What I do is I prepare Apollo moon rock samples for our scientists out in the community so that they can do research.
They keep all the rocks in the clean room, and for the lucky people who get to go in there, the price of admission is putting on this crazy suit that's supposed to keep all of your human stuff from getting anywhere near the rocks. The last step was an air shower.
Please watch your step.
It actually felt more like a light breeze.
There's moon rocks out there.
There are a bunch of clean rooms here at NASA Johnson, but this one is called the Lunar Pristine Samples Lab. That's because the moon rocks stored here have not been exposed to Earth air at all since they arrived back on Earth in the 60s and 70s.
Here you have a lot of water in the air, and you have a lot of oxygen in the air. And as soon as a rock is exposed to the Earth's surface, it gets attacked by those two things. And the minerals inside those rocks start to change immediately.
The pristine rocks are kept in these special cabinets that are filled with pure nitrogen instead of Earth air. And they have a higher pressure on the inside than the outside. So if air ever escapes, it comes out and away from the rocks instead of things going in to potentially contaminate the rocks.
It feels like it's hugging my arms really tight.
Yes.
There.
Uh-huh.
That's the pressure.
Yes.
All right, cool.
Only three materials can come into contact with these rocks. They're aluminum, Teflon, and stainless steel. So first you have your gloves and your bunny suit, then you have the gloves that let you reach into the cabinet, and if you want to pick up a sample directly, you have to put on Teflon gloves on top of that. So what the lunar sample processors do in this room is they prepare rocks to send out to researchers who can then study them. To do that, they have to break off little chips of the rocks. Sometimes they use buzz saws, sometimes they use a hammer and a chisel, sometimes they just scoop up some soil and weigh it, and then they can package it up and send it off into the world. I used to work in a lab where we worked with pictures of Mars from the Mars rover Spirit and Opportunity. My job was to process pictures of dirt as they were sent back to Earth. And all I wanted was to scoop up some of that Mars dirt and just let it run through my fingers. I figured this was the closest I could get to actually touching some extraterrestrial space dirt.
Am I allowed to reach in and hold the thing, or no? Because
I'm afraid not.
Can we do it? We cannot.
Unfortunately, no one is allowed to touch the moon rocks in the pristine lab. That's the whole point of the pristine lab. But I did get to hold a sample that was encased in this acrylic trophy, which was pretty darn good.
This is a moon rock in my hand.
When the processors are ready to send a sample out to a researcher, they pack them up really carefully, and then they just ship them out through the regular mail. They don't label it, this is a moon rock or anything. They don't label them fragile, and they don't even insure them, because what would you insure it for? They're priceless. When samples come back, researchers mail them back, and they're no longer pristine because they've been outside of those nitrogen cabinets. Those rocks are mostly available to use again in other studies. The processors keep very careful track of everything that has ever happened to them so that researchers know whether previous experiments can affect their current experiments.
At least a little bit of every single sample has been analyzed. We have roughly about 80% of our collection is still considered pristine. We have about 5% is out on display, about another 5% is out to our scientists around the world, and another 15% of each sample is in a remote storage facility at another NASA center, just in case something happened to this facility and we lost the samples in this facility.
One of the things these rocks have told us is that the moon probably formed in a giant impact, where the early Earth, when it was still hot and molten 4.5 billion years ago, collided with another protoplanet that might have been about the size of Mars. The debris from that collision splashed out into space and congealed to form the moon.
And I'm thinking of several pieces of really vesicular rock out here now.
At the end of Apollo 11, when Neil Armstrong was finishing up the first moonwalk ever, he was packing up the rocks into this sample box that they were going to bring back to Earth, and he saw that there was some space left in it, and he didn't want the big rocks to jostle around, so he threw in some scoops of soil to kind of cushion them.
Best idea that he could have had, because they ended up bringing back so much sample that there were a lot of outlying studies that could be done that wouldn't have gotten samples otherwise.
The soils from Apollo 11 contained these little white rocks called anorthosites. These are not very dense, these are really light rocks, and scientists thought that maybe they had floated to the surface of an ancient lunar magma ocean and formed a crust that used to cover most of the moon.
Over the years, instruments get better, new instrumentation is invented, new techniques come about.
There are questions we can answer now that scientists didn't even know to ask in the 70s. So keeping these samples pristine will help scientists for the next 50 years answer questions that we haven't even thought of today.